Hi.
Hello.
Can we pause the recording for now?
Oh, sure.
You are the right place. Hope you enjoy the music. So it's time to have a warm cup of coffee, tea, or a simple glass of water with you to join us.
Hello, everyone. Welcome.
Did your house go sold again? But your house not up for sale. Did you get a good lawyer?
Hope your dinner. So people are slowly joining us. Right, we're waiting for more to connect before getting started.
Anywhere, change the color of your hair. And are you busy? And did you have to pay that fine that you were diving all the time? Are you still dizzy?
Okay, so we are now 36 for the third edition. 38 now. Hello, everyone. Welcome.
I want you to come on over. Stop making a fool out of me.
Okay, we are now 40.
Hello, everyone, and welcome for this first Café Scientifique of the year. We're already 43, so we are going to wait maybe a few more minutes. Two more?
Yeah, okay.
So do not hesitate to get yourself a cup of coffee or some tea. Don't know what time it is, depending on the time of the place you are, but welcome.
So it's the moment also to show your cup of tea if you want. As I can see some video. I don't know if you can see mine. No. Maybe cannot see mine. Maybe I got yours.
I've got my water here.
Sorry, my glass doesn't show either.
Yeah, Christina, yes, thank you. Okay. So we can maybe slowly start. We have 44 participants now. So welcome, everyone. My name is Valentin Salamone. I work from AlterTox, one of the 15 partners of the PrecisionTox Consortium, and I will play the role of facilitator today, together with Jeanne Lapérouse, the communication coordinator of PrecisionTox, and Agatha Ormana, project manager from PrecisionTox from the University of Birmingham. Hello, Jeanne. Hello, Agatha. For this third Café Scientifique, so the next 1 hour and 30 minutes, we will dive into the world of Drosophila and toxicogenomics with Trudy McKay from Clemson University, is director, Center for the Human Genetics, professor at the Department of Genetics and Biochemistry, with Dr. Robert Arnold, distinguished professor of genetics and biochemistry also at the Center for the Human Genetics from Clemson University. Hello, Trudy. Hello, Roberts. So before giving you the floor, Trudy and Roberts, just a bit of housekeeping. So to all of you, if you encounter any technical problem during this meeting, please write it in the chat, and Jeanne, Agatha, and I will be here to help you. And important, at the end of the lecture, a session of Q&A is scheduled. So please, if you have any question, please write it in the chat and we will give you the floor. So Professor, the floor is yours and I wish you all a nice webinar.
Thank you, Jean. Thank you, Jonathan.
Thank you.
I would like to introduce now two other members of our team. Maria Adenay, a bioinformatician at the Center for Human Genetics, and Yuchan Janet Pan, a technician, Drosophila technician here at the Center for Human Genetics. And they will be also able to answer some of the questions that you may have. I'd like to start by talking about our role in the PhyloTox project. We are leading work package 4, which officially doesn't start until a year from now. But the goal of that work package is to understand genetic variants that confer susceptibility and resistance to the toxic effects of multiple chemicals, to try to determine what are common to multiple chemicals and what are unique to each one. And to do that, we use the fly model. So I'm going to introduce flies to you right now. But also, the effects of these chemicals are complicated and are in the realm of complex traits. So I'm going to start to tell you a little bit about complex traits or quantitative genetics. And it won't move, although it did earlier. There we go. So complex or quantitative traits are those that are distributed normally or approximately so in natural populations. And we know that that continuous distribution is due to both genetic and environmental variation and the interaction between them, gene-environment interaction. And so what the goal of complex trait genetics is to understand how primary variation in gene sequence among individuals in the population, indicated here as a small snippet of the genome of 4 individuals. And you can see the CG substitutions about the middle of your screen there. That's a SNP or a single nucleotide polymorphism. We have some small insertions and deletions and larger insertions and deletions. And we want to know how those naturally occurring variations in populations actually give rise to, as illustrated here, quantitative variation and aspects of morphology, behavior, and fitness. And so the answer to that question is the so-called genetic architecture, the genotype-phenotype map, whereby we seek to answer the following questions. You know, what are the genes that affect this variation? What are the variants within each gene, actually the alleles? And we'd like to know something about the effects of these variants. Are they the same in both sexes? Are they the same in different environments? And for our purposes, the environment is exposure or not to a toxic chemical. How many traits do they affect? Do the same genes that affect aspects of behavior, such as intellectual disability, and aspects of physiology, are they the same or are they different? And how are these genes interacting with each other to manifest the morphological, behavioral, neurological traits that we're examining? And of course, the big question is, can we use this information to actually predict the phenotype from our knowledge of the genotypes? And we're not so simplistic as to think that the SNPs directly affect the morphology, the behavior, fitness, but we know they do so via intermediate or endophenotypes of interactions of molecular interactions. These interactions can be at the level of transcripts, at the level of proteins, at the level of metabolites. And so that's a general overview of quantitative genomics. Now let me introduce you a little bit to the fruit fly model and why it's so powerful. So with these little flies, we have a large variety of genetic resources, some of which I'm going to describe in the next couple of slides. But essentially, we have mutations in practically every gene in the fly genome. We have natural populations that we can interrogate, more about that later. And we have the ability to control gene expression in space and time. And so combined, these are tools that we can bring to bear to address our toxicogenomic questions. We can also genetically manipulate these guys. We can essentially clone chromosomes, we can inbreed them, we can artificially select them, and I'll introduce you to some of those manipulations in the context of our project as well. And of course, they're a model organism in two senses. One sense is a very general sense, which is the properties that I explained on the previous slide, that is whether or not, you know, the effects are for males and females are separate, whether they affect different traits, whether the variants are in non-coding regions or protein-coding regions. These general phenomena are likely to translate across multiple taxa, which is the whole premise of phenotox. But also, it could be a model organism in the following sense, because of evolutionary conservation of genes and pathways across eukaryotes. It's very well possible that the exact same genes are active in Daphnia to humans. And what you won't know, because probably not fly people, is that Drosophila is genetically variable for practically any phenotype you have the ingenuity to develop a quantitative assay for. So for example, in our lab, among in addition to the toxicogenomics, we're also interested in feeding behavior, starvation resistance, sleep, circadian rhythm, sensitivity and resistance to ethanol, lifespan, aggression, locomotion. And I've shown you a little picture here of a NovaSeq, because essentially every gene expression trait, every transcript is actually a quantitative trait. Controlled by multiple genes in the environment. And of course, most relevant to this talk is the idea that responses to toxicants has some genetic basis. And so we're going to tell you a little bit today, specifically about work that we've done in lead and cadmium, and work that we have begun on arsenic using the fly model. So let me turn to the natural population that I told you about. Our lab generated the Drosophila melanogaster genetic reference panel. So Dr. Richard Lyman in the lab went to a natural population, the Raleigh Farmers Market, and he caught wild type female flies and he took them into the lab. And he inbred them for 20 generations. So when we moved to Clemson, there were 205 such lines. But since then, we have expanded the DGRP to 1,400 inbred lines. All of these lines have been sequenced to about 40x using Illumina technology. And 200 of them have been sequenced using long-read Pacific Biosciences sequencing. This is for the experts here, the inbred lines have at least twice and likely more genetic variation represented among them than you would see if you just looked at normally outbred members of the population. And the key is these are replicated genotypes. They're inbred. That means that each line is more or less exactly the same genotype, but the different lines represent the genetic diversity present in that natural population. But the genetic diversity is frozen, as it were. So investigators all around the world can get these freely accessible stocks from the Bloomington Drosophila Stock Center and measure whatever they want on them. And so that means that we can look across multiple phenotypes, multiple environments. And for many of the traits that we examine are behavioral traits, which have low individual level heritabilities, which is the fraction of the entire variation due to the effects of genetic variation. But when we measure many individuals per genotype, we can get a much better increase in genetic signal. So it is this resource and resources descended from it that we are using to perform our genetic interrogations. And we have lots of genetic variation. We haven't completely compiled all of the sequence data for the 1400 inbred lines, but the initial 205 had 4.6 million variants. So we're going to have a lot more than the 5 million that I mentioned here. So that's a lot of genetic variation for a single population of flies. There's something quite interesting about flies that makes them almost better than humans for mapping complex traits. Those of you familiar with humans will know that genetic variation in the human genome is partitioned in LD blocks. Within each block, there's a high correlation of allele frequencies. So what that means in practice is that you can get a signal from a region of a chromosome, but it's very, very hard to delve within that region and find out which are the causal genes, and almost impossible to find out what are the causal variants simply from observations on the population. But in flies, this linkage disequilibrium decays very rapidly, certainly within a gene and sometimes between adjacent base pairs. So we have much higher mapping precision to say that particular genes actually do, well, are associated with the trait. And so when we have our association mapping, we'll measure all of the DGRP lines for a trait of interest, say survival, when exposed to a particular concentration of the toxicant. And then we go through each of those 5 million variants in the genome that are common one at a time. And we say, we split the population into the two homozygous classes because they're inbred lines, no heterozygotes. And we say the lines that are homozygous for one variant differ in phenotype from the ones that are homozygous for the other variant at a locus. Yes or no? So I've illustrated two examples here. The one on your left, as you look at the screen, is no association. There's no difference depending on genotype. And to the right, there is an association. So we repeat that for every single common variant in the genome, 3 million of them, say, and use this program to account for covariates in the population. And then we can plot the results in a form like this, where on the x-axis are each of the 5 major chromosome arms in the fly genome and the tiny, largely heterochromatic dot chromosome 4. And then we can apply a significance threshold above which we think there is an enrichment for false positives. In humans, we normally apply a 10 to the minus 8 Bonferroni type correction, but our experience in fly genetics is something like this, where we look at the number of observed and expected associations and find that typically there is enrichment beyond 10 to the minus 5. And because we're in flies and we use the original GWAS to do further tests down the lines, we're more worried about false negatives than false positives. So in fact, we typically pick less than 10 to the minus 5 as an operational significance threshold backed up by these QQ plots. We have another option, and mostly some of what we're going to describe is based on this, is that we can make infinitely large populations of flies to screen by taking a subset of the DGRP lines, intercrossing them in the initial generation in a manner that ensures that all are equally represented, and then keeping them in very, very large populations. We typically keep them in populations of 800 individuals per generation for many, many generations. So we call this an advanced intercross population. Its advantage over the DGRP is twofold. If we have an intercross population with 40 DGRP lines, that means that any one unique variant in the entire population will be represented at a frequency of 1 in 40, rather 1 in 1400. And so we can actually kind of gauge the effect of those rare variants, which we can't do with the DGRP per se. The other advantage is we can create infinitely many random genotypes that we can then assess. But because we don't have infinite money and cannot figure out the genotype for every single fly, we use a trick. So we measure many, many, many flies, thousands of them, and then select, say, the most resistant ones in the rightmost panel, the right circle that circles the high pools, those that are, say, surviving longest after being exposed to a toxicant. And we either select the bottom pool for quantitative traits or random selection for survival challenge. And we sequence these in bulk, which means that we can, in a single round of sequencing, get estimates of allele frequency, and then do what is essentially a bulk segregant analysis or extreme QTL mapping, and do a GWAS asking now, is there a difference in allele frequency between our two selected populations? And if there is, then of course, the SNP is either causal or in LD with the causal SNP. We can also, once we have developed an hypothesis from our initial GWAS, can go in there and use those reagents that I said exist for flies. I've shown here one kind of reagent, which is RNA interference, where there are publicly available libraries of all Drosophila genes that have an RNA hairpin loop and driven by the yeast UAS driver. And then we can cross them to promoter of anything that you want, an ubiquitous promoter, a promoter for a gene that's only expressed in the nervous system, you name it, knock down expression of that gene, and then evaluate whether or not it affects the phenotype of interest, and in such a way, functionally validate the hypotheses that you generated from the GWAS. There's another way that we can functionally validate hypotheses, and that is going to DGRP lines that you did not actually phenotype in the first round. So you hold some samples, hold some lines out, develop your hypotheses about what are the actual SNPs that you're interested in, and then take those lines that have not been tested, cross the alternative homozygotes amongst themselves, and determine whether or not your SNP of interest is associated with the phenotypes. This is particularly important when your SNP is in an intergenic region for which there are no publicly available RNA interference resources. That's what I said. So I'm going to turn it over to Robert, and he's going to tell us something about heavy metals.
So now that Trudy has set the stage for why we like to use Drosophila as a model for toxicogenomics, let's take a look at heavy metals. So heavy metals are ubiquitous in the environment. And of course, they cannot be degraded because they're chemical elements. Some heavy metals are essential for life, for example, iron and zinc and trace elements of copper and selenium are essential for living organisms, but others metals are highly toxic. And in our laboratory, we have focused on over the years on four toxic heavy metals. Mostly today, we'll talk about lead, cadmium, and just studies that we have just started recently on arsenic. We've also done in collaboration with Matthew Rand's lab in Rochester, some work on methyl mercury. So why are these heavy metals important? Let's take a look at some of them. Lead has been very widespread in the environment. Lead paints used to be very, very common. And still, there are many buildings, especially old houses, in which the paint contains lead. Lead is also, of course, used to be found in gasoline, although these days people try to sell unleaded gas. And lead has especially become important in countries like Africa or Asia in lead pipes that are used for drinking water. Cadmium has been used in the manufacture of batteries and acrylic paints. Both cadmium and lead have a very long persistence once they enter our body. Cadmium replaces calcium in bone, which can be result in serious bone disorders. A famous example is in Japan, Itai disease, which resulted from lead that was absorbed via rice pads in rice that was consumed by people and resulted in serious bone deformations. Cadmium, when it enters the bloodstream, binds to a protein called methylothionine, and which is used to remove cadmium via excretion in the kidneys. However, in the kidneys and the proximal tubules, methylothionine and cadmium separate, and cadmium then causes serious kidney damage. This is another consequence of cadmium poisoning. Methylmercury, of course, is most famous for its accumulation in seafood. I don't want to discourage anybody from eating sushi, but what happens is that that methylmercury, which derives from volcanic activity from the Earth's crust, is absorbed by small organisms in the ocean that are being eaten by bigger organisms, by small fish, and then the big fish eats the small fish and mercury accumulates. So it is often recommended that pregnant women do not consume fish such as tuna. And then finally, there's arsenic, which is found mostly as a contaminant in groundwater around the world. And in fact, arsenic is a major environmental toxicant, which affects more than 200 million people worldwide. And in the United States, it has recently become quite important in that it is a major component of coal ash, that is the residue from burning coal for energy. And from the coal ash, it can enter groundwater and contaminate drinking water. It's especially a big problem in countries like Bangladesh, Vietnam, China, but also in certain regions in the United States. Now, children are especially at risk for exposure to heavy metals. And the reason for that is that heavy metals like lead and arsenic can cross the blood-brain barrier and enter the central nervous system, and it can also cross the placenta. And lead exposure is especially of concern due to the adverse effects of low concentration on cognitive development in children, since the nervous system still continues to develop during childhood, especially areas such as the hippocampus, which undergoes neurogenesis throughout life. You see on the left side a survey by UNICEF that shows that about a third of the world's children are affected by lead poisoning, primarily in South Asia and in Africa. And much of that lead poisoning is due to effects from drinking water. Something is happening to the slide. Someone is doodling on the slide. Martin Wojciech is messing with my slides. Martin Wojciech. Could you please not mess with my slides, Martin? Thank you. And of course, in the United States, in recent years, lead contamination has become a very important consideration in drinking water in Michigan, in Flint. Now, not all individuals are equally susceptible to the effects of environmental toxin exposure. There is, of course, a genetic predisposition to either susceptibility or resistance to heavy metals. But determining these genetic risk factors for susceptibility to heavy metal toxicity is very challenging in human populations because we don't know the frequency or the duration and the dose of exposure mostly. And the phenotypic manifestations of toxicity are very diverse, and they often appear long after the actual exposure has occurred. So humans in general are really not very good experimental systems. We cannot control the genetic background. We cannot control the developmental history and the environmental exposure, often to multiple toxicants in the environment at the same time. The generation time is very long compared to Drosophila, where the generation time is about 14 days. Humans live for about 20 years, have generation time for about 20 years or so, and that makes it very difficult to perform genetic studies on humans. We don't have a lot of generations to look at. And there is restricted access to biological material. We can take blood, we can take saliva samples, maybe some skin biopsies, but we cannot easily take out parts of the brain of a person like we can do in animal systems. And we cannot manipulate people genetically like we can do with the flies. And so as Trudy pointed out earlier, flies, besides these advantages, are very powerful model because about 67% of Drosophila genes have a human ortholog. And flies are susceptible to the toxic effects of heavy metals, as Trudy already has shown you earlier, which we'll talk about a little bit more later. And we can identify genes and networks that are associated with sensitivity to lead or cadmium. And we can translate these Drosophila genetic networks to human networks by superimposing human orthologs on these Drosophila candidate genes. And at this point, I'm going to let Trudy tell you a little bit more about our studies on lead acetate.
Thank you. So I'm going to go back to our friends, the DGRP flies, and talk about an experiment that we've done to assess the effects of lead acetate on viability of the flies, development time, and their locomotor activity. So here is an illustration of the experiment where the different color flies represent, in this case, the 205 initial DGRP lines that we had. And for each line, we take many individuals and we rear the flies on either standard fly food or standard fly food supplemented with lead acetate. And of course, we have multiple replicates for each of those treatments. And so now I have to introduce you to a little bit more of a complex idea, which is that of genotype environment interaction. And so let me introduce some terms to you. I've showed you before how we quantify the effect of a genetic variant on a phenotype. And so the panel to your left shows the same panel that I showed you before, where individuals are either AA at a particular locus, remember these flies are all homozygous, or TT for the alternative allele at that locus. And in this example, the two genotypes have a different phenotype. On the panel on the right, I've shown you flies from the same strain. So these are all AA flies. And I've reared them in two different environments, say lead medium and control medium. And I'm looking at the effect on some phenotype, say development time. And if E2 is lead and E1 is regular, then that there's a difference in between those environments and development time. They take longer to develop on lead. That is called environmental sensitivity. And those two concepts I think are quite clear. Where it gets complicated is when we talk about differences in sensitivity for different genotypes. So look a minute at the panel in the middle. This is an example where we grow flies in normal food, environment one, lead food, environment two, and we have our two color-coded genotypes now, AA and TT. What you can see in this cartoon is that for both genotypes, lead increases the time they take to development, to develop. But, and there's a difference between the different, there's a difference between the AA and the TT genotypes. TTs in general take longer than AAs. But there is, in this case, we say there's no genotype environment interaction because the response of both genotypes is the same in both environments. The two examples on the far left and the far right illustrate cases of genotype environment interaction and generally shows that such an interaction can take two forms. On the left of your screen, the interaction causes a change in variance. So in environment one, there's some difference between the AA and the TTs, but it's exacerbated in environment two. So we call that a change in variance. It can, in the far right panel, you see that there's genotype AA is much greater affected by lead than TT. So TT is relatively less sensitive to lead, where AA is relatively more sensitive to lead, to the extent that the reaction norms, which are these little lines joining the means of the genotypes in both environments, show. So this is a visual way of observing whether or not there's genotype environment interaction. So if I go back to the lead experiment now, I'm going to show you what we found at the level of phenotypes. And you can, I think, see that in all cases, there's substantial genotype environment interaction. Before I do that, I'm going to sneak in some statistics. So the experiment is a classical factorial design experiment, and we can determine whether or not there's differences between males and females, that's the sex term, whether or not there's differences between lead treatment versus no lead treatment. That's the environmental sensitivity I talked to you about. Whether or not there's differences among DGRP lines, that is the genetic variation. And then all of these interaction terms, which are somewhat interesting. So sex by environment tells you whether or not the difference between male and females is the same in the two environments. Line by sex is genetic variation and sexual dimorphism. That is that the difference between males and females is different between the DGRP genotypes. These last two terms are the ones that we're most interested in because it shows that there's genetic variation in sensitivity to lead. And so we're really quite interested in what are those sensitive genotypes and what are those much more resistant genotypes. And of course, it might be that in fact, G by E is different in males and females. So here's some data. I'm going to show you three data slides and then I'm going to pass it over to Robert. So here we have viability. And in the top left panel, you can see, not surprisingly, that when we grow the flies on lead, they have a severe effect on survival. So only about 40% of the flies survive average over all DGRP lines on lead, whereas more like 65% survive average over all DGRP lines on controlled food. That's illustrated here, looking at the different lines. And you can see the colors aren't that great, but there really is substantial variation in environmental sensitivity. Some lines are much more sensitive than others, although they all go down. This picture, I think, is more easy to understand in the bar graph at the bottom, where the little red spots here is the viability of the different DGRP lines, egg to adult viability. Arranged from lowest to highest. And you can see that some of the DGRP lines are pretty sick, others are quite good. And then what happens when they're reared on lead? And it's really obvious that the magnitude of reduction of viability varies among the lines. I mean, for some lines, they seem to even do better on lead. well, they certainly don't do worse than normal food. So that's of interest. That tells us that there is substantial genetic variation for the effects of lead during development on survivorship of the flies. Very similar case for development time. Here we've split them into males and females. And again, it takes, on average, over all the degenerate P-lines, they takes them a longer time to develop on lead. So not only don't they survive, the ones that do survive are taking longer to develop. So that's considered a negative fitness test. The cross-environment genetic correlation is really quite low. The lines aren't very well separated in this reaction norm plot, but you can see it much better when we look across the DGRP lines ranked again. So what we have here is development time. Low is considered to be good and high is considered to be bad. They range considerably in development time from, you know, 10 is considered to be an average, but some are very quick developing, and that particular quick developing, that particular quick developing line actually was very highly affected by lead. And you can see that, again, some lines are more or less immune in terms of development time to the lead treatment. So there's a lot of genetic variation. When we measure locomotion, we use an apparatus called a Drosophila activity monitor. And so what these are, monitors, you have a little vial in here with some food at the bottom, plugged with cotton at the top so the air circulation occurs. And then every time the fly crosses from one side of the vial to another, it trips a laser beam and a count is recorded. And in that way, we have computerized activity monitors throughout the day and over multiple days from which we can compute not only waking activity, but also sleep and circadian rhythm. So we did that for the DGRP lines. And here we have locomotor activity. Now, this is a very interesting case because it turns out that averaged over all lines, there's actually no difference whether or not they're treated by lead. But when you look at the breakout on the bottom left, you can see that there's, again, a great deal of genetic variation and sensitivity with a lot of crossing of reaction norms, indicating that in some cases, the effect is opposite than what you might expect in lead. So in some cases, lead increases activity. In some cases, lead decreases activity. And that becomes very obvious when you look at the effects of every single line. And yeah, there are just as many lines that are more active, hyperactive when exposed to lead, as there are that are hypoactive or have reduced activity. So I'm going to now turn it over to Robert, and he'll tell you how we can genetically analyze these types of phenotypic data.
So we can take the differences between the phenotype on exposed to lead versus exposed to control food, and we can use that as a parameter for genome-wide association analysis. And here we see the three phenotypes that Judy mentioned earlier: viability, development time for sexes separately, and locomotor activity. And as Judy indicated, the cutoff value that we use empirically in flies is a p-value of 10 to the minus 5. And what we show here in a little bit exaggerated size of these circles are SNPs in candidate genes that are above that threshold. And we can see a few things from carefully looking at this data. First, if there are, well, first, there are quite a few genes in each panel, which tells us that there are multiple genes that are associated with variation in sensitivity to exposure to lead acetate. And also when we look at the two sexes and we compare them, we see that there are maybe, that there are some genes that are in common between the sexes, but that there's also a lot of sexual dimorphism. So we can look at that whole collection of genes independent of the phenotype, any gene that affects any of the three phenotypes that, that we have assessed. And we can then ask, can we construct genetic networks for susceptibility to lead exposure? And that is illustrated here. And what you see here is that the square yellow boxes indicate genes that surpass the 10 to the minus 5 threshold level for any one of those three phenotypes in the association analysis. And the ovals show genes that we could computationally recruit into the network based on known genetic interactions. And to go a little step further, wherever you see a blue font, that illustrates, that indicates a candidate gene that has a well-defined human counterpart, human ortholog. So this is now the first example that I'm showing you of how we can construct genetic networks on which we can superimpose human counterparts. Now, what have we learned so far about the genetic basis of variation in sensitivity to lead? Well, we have shown that the genetic architecture for sensitivity to developmental exposure to lead is polygenic and it's sexually dimorphic. And when we look carefully at these genes and ask what is the function of each of these genes, we find that many of these genes are associated with early development of the nervous system. Especially axon guidance, axonogenesis, neurotransmitter signaling, sensory organ development, so that it appears that variation in at the level of the genome results in variation in neuronal connectivity in the nervous system, and that such subtle variations in neuronal connectivity in the nervous system may underlie variation in sensitivity to environmental exposures, in this case, to exposure to lead. So here we have now been able to make a link between variation at the level of the genome to variation at the level of the nervous system to variation at in the level of organismal phenotype. Now, let's go back to some statistical considerations. Trudy mentioned earlier that the threshold value that we used for this genome-wide association analysis is p less than 10 to the minus 5. This does not represent a Bonferroni corrected threshold, but it is supported by quantile-quantile plots. And it should be noted here that the Bonferroni corrected threshold in general is probably too severe because it presumes that there is no correlation between the various tests, whereas we know that gene expression is highly correlated across the genome. However, all polymorphisms in the DGRP are known, so that this particular cutoff value actually captures the top SNPs in the population that are associated with the phenotype. And then we can actually use functional validation of the gene level. We can use either mutants or RNAi, which Trudy explained earlier, to establish an empirical false discovery rate. So the question we ask is, when we use a mutant or we suppress expression of a gene by targeted RNA interferences, if we suppress the expression of a candidate gene that harbors a variant associated with variation in sensitivity to heavy metal, does that affect the sensitivity to the heavy metal? And by doing this, I'll show you some examples of that later, about 60 to 80% of the genes that harbor associated polymorphisms can generally be functionally confirmed. As Trudy mentioned earlier, we have the DGRP lines are a fantastical resource, but their power is limited because they're only, at least in the initial DGRP, there were only 200 lines. And that means that rare alleles with minor allele frequencies of less than 0.05 cannot be detected. And as Trudy mentioned, we can get around that by generating an advanced intercross population from a subset of DGRP lines that will increase statistical power and enable the detection of rare alleles. And so that is what we did for exposure to lead and for exposure to cadmium. And so first, what we did is we looked at the dose response relationship for survival on lead acetate and cadmium chloride in one of these advanced intercross populations. And one of the things that you may notice first, of course, each line, each color represents a particular concentration of toxin. And it turns out that these advanced intercross populations, the outbred flies, are less sensitive than the inbred line. So the concentrations here are higher than the concentrations that we've previously used to survey the inbred DGRP lines. You can also see that if you look closely, that in general, females are less sensitive to lead or cadmium than the males. So this immediately tells us that, again, there's probably a bit of sexual dimorphism in sensitivity in this population to both heavy metals. Now, we can do the extreme QTL mapping, which Trudy explained earlier, in which we take a pool of flies that are extreme survivors when grown on heavy metals versus a randomly selected number of flies from the same population. And we can look at differences of allele frequencies when we perform bulk DNA sequencing of these extremes. And what the arrows here show you is the increased statistical power. These indicate the cutoff lines, the statistical for statistical thresholds. And you can see that they approach the Bonferroni corrected threshold. And in fact, there are some of the little dots that you can see are really highly, highly significant at a level at which we could not identify them earlier in a survey of the DGRP lines. Another thing that you can see is that the two heavy metals, if you look closely, cadmium in the lower levels and lead in the upper levels are somewhat different. But you can also see yet again that if when we compare the sex between males and females, there are some signals that are similar in the among the two the two sexes, but there is substantial sexual dimorphism. So here, the genome-wide association profiles are largely distinct for lead and cadmium, although we can identify also common candidate genes. And we observe, again, a polygenic architecture for both heavy metals with extensive sexual dimorphism. Now, we can look at these genes that surpass our criterion for statistical significance and ask what kind of functions do they have? And again, when we look at gene ontology enrichment analysis, what we see again is what we found earlier, this our survey on the DGRP lines, that there is that the type of gene ontology categories that appear are neuronal differentiation, generation of neurons, basically anything that is related to early development and function of the nervous system. I mentioned earlier that we can, in Drosophila, use mutational analysis and RNAi to validate the effects of candidate genes on the phenotype that we measure. And that is illustrated here, where we look at the difference in survival between control flies and flies that are either targeted in panels A or B is with a transposon, with an element that is inserted, or in panels C and D targeted by RNAi. On the top two panels, we see FX exposures to lead, and on the bottom, cadmium. And in each case, we assess effects of the same genes on both of the heavy metals. The red colors indicate the females, and the blue colors indicate males. And you can see that if there is no difference between control and mutants that the bar is essentially non-existent, like in the lead panel A, the third gene CG17193 doesn't show any effect on lead, but there are other genes that are highly significant. So when we use a mutation against, for example, DPR8, we see that the males, in fact, when that gene is suppressed, the males actually survive longer on lead, because it's below the line is longer survival, above the line is shorter survival. In most cases, the survival is shorter. In some cases, the survival is longer. And whenever you see asterisks, that indicates a level of statistical significance. Now, the other thing to note is that the blue and red bars are not always the same. In fact, there are some cases in which they go in opposite directions. So this illustrates, again, sexual dimorphism, that if we target a candidate gene with either a transposable element or with RNAi, that the effects that we see when we then expose these animals to lead or cadmium, that it can be opposite in the two sexes. And finally, we can see that there are genes that are associated with susceptibility to lead, but not to cadmium, and vice versa. Now, one of the things that we can do is we can look at that data set and we can again ask, can we construct networks? And the way we did, and what this particular slide shows is networks in panel A for just sensitivity to lead with the sexes combined, in B, sensitivity to cadmium for the sexes combined, and in C and D, the sexes separately for each, for both of the heavy metals combined. Here, the purple boxes indicate genes that are associated with heavy metal binding. And the yellow boxes indicate genes in which we have validated their function using RNAi. And the one red circle that you see there is a gene that is both associated with heavy metal binding and that also has been validated with RNAi. Now, what you see here is that these networks are actually fairly wimpy. They don't interconnect much, because we have not included here computationally recruited genes. What we can do now is we can say, okay, let's just take all of the data against both heavy metals for males and females combined, and just ask, what is there an Uber network that we can identify that contains elements that are associated with genetic susceptibility to either of the heavy metals for any sex? And when we do that, we can construct a much larger integrated network, in which here the orange bars show gene products that are physically associated, whereas the green edges show genetic interactions between the genes. And so you see here there is one large network as well as still a few smaller pairwise interactions and a few smaller networks. But now we can go to where we really want to go, and we can ask, can we superimpose on these networks human orthologs and construct, in doing so, a network of human genes that contains genes that may be associated with lead sensitivity and or cadmium sensitivity? And when we do that, we get a large network. This is the network derived from the Drosophila network of human genes that would correspond to sensitivity of Drosophila to lead and cadmium in males and females. And so the advantage of these orthologous networks is that they provide functional contexts for known human targets of heavy metal toxicity. And they also implicate novel candidate susceptibility genes. And we can now ask, what are the hub genes in that network? What do they do? And so here are the human hub genes in these orthologous networks. And we can see, for example, that they're quite interesting, and a number of them are associated with calcium-dependent processes. such as FN1 and VDR and TJP1, calcium binding, calcium functions, or calcium-mediated signaling. Again, there are genes associated with neural differentiation, like RYK, or with stem cell population maintenance and RNA binding, like ELOF, or with epigenetic modification, like CTBP1, which regulates histone acetylation. And I particularly want to draw your attention to the last one on this table. This is VDR. VDR encodes the vitamin D3 receptor, which is a calcium binding protein that is important for the formation of bone. And the reason VDR is particularly interesting is that it has actually been associated previously with sensitivity to lead exposure in human studies. So this then provides a proof of principle for the validity of our work on Drosophila to translate findings for sensitivity to heavy metals to human populations. So we can now cycle back to Drosophila and say, okay, let's go to Drosophila orthologs of these human genes and again see if we can validate them using RNAi as being associated with lead or cadmium. And as you can see, we can validate almost every one of them, or pretty much every one of them, against at least one of each of the two heavy metal exposures in at least one of the sections. And what is particularly dramatic here in some cases is the extensive sexual dimorphism that you observe here. In fact, what we see here is extensive sexual antagonism. For example, you look at MRP in cadmium, the males survive quite well, the females are highly sensitive. The same is true for a gene called LERP, LARP, or for GRIP in cadmium. And so at this time, we decided to extend our studies on heavy metal by looking at the effects of a third heavy metal, arsenic. And this is where Janet Pan and Mario Adonai came in. Janet used the same advanced intercross population to look at the dose response for survival on sodium arsenide in sexes separately. And what you can see here is that the flies are highly sensitive to arsenic toxicity. Females, again, are more resistant overall than males, which tells us again that here the response is also highly sexually dimorphic. And when we choose an intermediate concentration of 0.8 millimolar sodium arsenide, 50% of the males survive on average for 1 day, and about 50% of the females for about 2.5 days. So this enables us to actually do experiments very quickly, given the relatively short survival times on arsenide at this concentration. So what Janet did is she performed again the extreme QTL mapping that Trudy introduced earlier, using a block design in which she exposed in each block 250 males and 250 females to sodium arsenide. And then she collected the 10 to 50% longest survivors for each sex, and also collected a random sample of the same number of untreated flies. She measured a total of 6,000 flies. Now, that number may not seem very much, but let's for a moment think about people who do toxicological studies on rodents. Think of measuring 6,000 mice or 6,000 rats, and you have an impression about what a large experiment this actually is. She collected 12 blocks, yielding 300 flies for each sex per treatment. And then she performed bulk DNA sequencing on the NovaSeq 6000 platform to identify differentially segregating alleles between flies exposed to sodium arsenide and randomly selected untreated controls. And then those data came to our bioinformatician, Maria Adonai, who is currently still in the process of analyzing them The data set looks extremely interesting, but is not yet complete. So unfortunately, I have to leave you here with a little bit of a teaser. And I hope that in the next webinar, I can actually show you our data on arsenite. So what have you learned then today? That first we have learned that extreme UTL mapping using Drosophila melanogaster is an effective approach for the identification of allelic variants associated with variation in resistance to environmental toxins. And second, that Drosophila can serve as an effective high-throughput discovery system for autologous candidate genes and networks that can subsequently be tested for variation in susceptibility to toxicant exposure in rodent models and human populations. And so at this time, I think we're perfectly on time to answer questions if there are any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Robert, and thank you very much, Trudy, for this really nice and interesting talk. Indeed, we are perfectly on time. We have some question from the chat. John Colburn was particularly active. So John, if you want to show, to open your video and have some comment, please feel free to show you. Okay, John, you can unmute yourself. Hello.
Thank you, Valentin. Robert and Trudy, thank you so very much for an exciting presentation once again. I'm always amazed with how well and clearly you can explain very complex biological experiments. My question to both of you is about really that cross-species extrapolation of the results that you're obtaining. Obviously, what you're doing is that you're mapping the homology between Daphne and humans based on the orthology of their genes, and basically creating a network of those genes based on a known genetic interaction of these genes in Drosophila. How often or what kind of data do we have to suggest that the interactions, those genetic interactions that are measurable in Drosophila are also conserved in humans? Otherwise, the orthology of the interaction, not simply just of the genes themselves.
I think that's an excellent question, and I'm not so sure that we know the answer. And to explain why, at least I don't know the answer immediately, let's think about how genetic interactions are defined in flies. These are primarily done using very severe null alleles that will cause the fly to die at some point during its development. And we're just looking at time of death as an output and an epistatic interaction there. What does surprise me a little bit is that we are recapitulating genetic interactions of the same genes that interact in those developmental assays in flies when we look at quantitative traits, which I think is kind of interesting and possibly unappreciated. But how do we know then what are interactions in humans? We can't do those developmental studies. Possibly in cell lines, we could try and recapitulate them. And possibly, I'm just plain ignorant, and that other people know what these interactions are in humans. I think that Phenotox has got it right, and that the way to address this question is to look at same versus same interactions, that is, transcriptional co-regulation, is comparing apples to apples. Protein-protein metabolomics is comparing apples to apples. And when we get that information, that I think will make us stand on a more solid footing. Don't know if Robert has any other.
I think that Trudy answered the question very well. As always, she does.
I could maybe therefore comment for some of the members who are attending this. Of course, there are a lot of people who are interested in the PrecisionTox project because of its potential to be helpful in the regulation of chemicals, and those cross-species extrapolations become very, very important. And I think that many people are always trying to deal with those uncertainties. And as scientists, of course, we're trying to come up with ways by which we can communicate those uncertainties in a meaningful way so that regulators and risk managers can make the sound decisions. And while you were talking, I was thinking to myself, well, you know, there's a lot of things that we do as scientists to deal with those uncertainties. Like, for instance, the power of concordance, the power of basically observing the same phenomena multiple times via different angles on the problem. And I suspect that over the next 4 years, we'll probably be having these discussions on how best to communicate these uncertainties and to allow people to make sound decisions based on rethinking how it is that we deal with these unknowns.
John, I may be able to expand on your question a little bit. Trudy, Robert, Dan Jacobson from Oak Ridge, we normally run into each other in NIDA circles, so it's really, really great to see you here. And, you know, lovely talk, and I really love the perspective of you know, not using arbitrary p-value thresholds from the human community as gold truth. We know that in doing so, you absorb a lot of false negatives, and in the beautiful experimental systems you have, you can test those. And I would contend we could even dig deeper than than 10 to the minus 5 in the Drosophila data. And as you probably heard us talk about a little bit in NIDA circles, the network-driven and explainable AI-driven systems that we're building are designed specifically to do that, because our hypothesis is that network connectivity, you know, interactions between biological components of the same system, can be used as a filter to get rid of false positives. If you have p-values that are standing alone and have no connectivity to any part of the rest of the system responding as a phenotype, that's probably a false positive you can winnow out. So I would say on the Drosophila side, we could even dig deeper and help you filter out the false positives. And we've also built very large networks, multiplex networks across many different tissues, 57 different tissues, in fact, in humans, with lots of different types of data, be it transcriptomic or proteomic or protein-protein interaction or genetic and so on. So we have millions and millions of lines of evidence showing interactions between genes. And to John's question specifically, we can look at the sort of genetic interaction and omic interactions in Drosophila, and then put those into our multiplex networks in humans and see how many lines of evidence there are for interactions of those genes in humans. And we're doing this already routinely across species, where we do GWAS in one species and run it through networks built in other species. And it works really beautifully. Really nice biology falls out. And so I think there'd be a great set of collaborations just waiting here for us to really mine this sort of data together, if you're willing and don't want to run away screaming.
Oh, I love it. I think, let's continue to talk. Can I just say one thing before Robert says something? With respect to John's original questions, to what extent are Drosophila networks conserved in humans? Well, I certainly can't tell you exactly, but do be aware that many of the pathways that were first discovered in flies are also human pathways. Think of notch signaling. Those are all bristle development genes, but we know that notch and hairy and suppressor of hairy wing and all those things have human orthologs. So I totally agree with Daniel. And I think that information combined with Daniel's machine learning and AI approaches, combined with the idea that maybe these developmental interactions are recapitulated at the level of quantitative phenotypes, all start to make sense if we're willing to embrace it.
I think we can even go deeper than tissue specificity, where we now these have explainable AI methods for single cell data going out. So we can build cell type and even cell state specific regulatory networks out of single cell data. And we have a paper coming out. I mean, I just approved the proofs for Science Translational Medicine on this method, using this used it in a mouse study, but the method is there to be able to really dig down to cell type specific and even state specific patterns that I think will help the interpretation and of this within and across species over time. I mean, it's an exciting time to be a biologist, right?
I think, so I think that's very exciting. And it's exactly, I think we are looking at in parallel views. The one thing that I wanted to mention, I think that one of the points that you made on that the constructing networks can be a good filter for filtering out filtering out negatives. I think we actually see that empirically in the work that we do. If we look at, if we have a list of genes from, say, a DGRP screen, and we randomly select a number of genes and do RNAi targeting on them, we normally can validate that P less than 10 to minus 5, maybe 60 to 80% of them, depending on the phenotype that we look at. But if we look at, if we target genes of which are part of the network that we have constructed with RNAi, I would say that virtually all of them validate in the network. So that is a very well taken point. Another point that I think I want to say, which you didn't talk about today, but this was published last year. We published a paper by Baker et al. In PNAS with Trudy that dealt actually with cocaine, not necessarily toxins, but recreational drugs, in which we devised, I point at Trudy here, who's the smart one. Remember, I'm only the cheerleader, she's the brains. We actually devised a way in which we could actually validate not just at the gene level, but at the actual SNP level. And of course, Trudy mentioned that we expanded the DGRP from 200 lines to 1400 lines. And one of the things that allows us to do in the future is out of sample testing, in that we can use a subset of these lines, keep them, hold them back. And then we can select lines that are fixed for particular SNPs that have been implicated by a screen of the DGRP, and test those lines and ask, do SNPs that are fixed in random backgrounds actually affect the traits of interest? So, and I think that is your expertise on, I think it could be a wonderful collaboration. You're getting me quite excited about it, Dan.
Now there's some very cool stuff we should be doing on the Equitox side and on the SUD side as well, all around these concepts. You're perfectly set up, obviously, with these beautiful populations. I think I mentioned in a previous workshop for NIDA, we're also doing a lot of work with Robert Huber on high throughput behavioral phenotyping to capture a whole ranges of other behavioral phenotypes, which would be very cool to intersect both in the phylotoxins as well as the substance use disorder work. I think there's just so many cool intersects to explore here.
Thank you, Daniel, and thank you, Robert and Trudy. So there is other questions, so we'll make sure to let everybody participate. So we have a question from Nicolas Koltman. So Nicolas, if you want, you can turn on your video. I can just say the question. So the question is in terms, okay, so Nicolas, hello.
Hello. I have a general interest in preclinical and regulatory toxicology species that use for chemical safety, drug discovery, etc. Whilst it's not been the main point of this talk, I wonder if you guys have any data sets from Drosophila where you have tried to separate whole flies into individual tissues, and where we might find those, and how you guys go about mapping organ and tissue ontologies to, say, human or to other mammalian tetrapods.
So I can explain that in general. I think Robert has an answer too. So we haven't done it in the detail that the Fly Atlas group in Glasgow has done it, or that the mod encode, the Drosophila mod encode people have done it. Those data are all on flybase. And so indeed, we have publicly available data, unfortunately only for one strain, but for these purposes, it doesn't matter, for what genes are expressed in different developmental stages of flies, as well as different body parts. I won't go so far as to call it tissues, but you can imagine that people are thinking of doing single cell atlases of these body parts to actually get it down to tissue specific changes. And so if you have gene expression maps that are tissue specific and even cell type specific in flies, in Daphnia, in whatever, we can then compare that to GTEx in humans and infer generally what are mappings of one type to another. Nervous tissues, obviously, completely orthologous between species. Swim bladder, which you said in your question, only if there's a developmental origin that would be similar, because, you know, flies and mice and humans don't have swim bladders. So I think it's like a really, really interesting question. And I think it's a question to which we could get very concrete answers.
And you mentioned GTEC. We've already used these explainable AI methods on all the GTEC tissue types to build, we believe, really highly accurate expression relationships of all the genes and all the tissues. And we've shown these methods are about an order of magnitude, if not more accurate than traditional co-expression approaches. So we think we have some really good ways to look at that data with high confidence.
Yeah, and then now if we compare across species, we'll be able to map, you know, what is a gallbladder in a fly, at least developmentally, or, you know, where are species, like, obviously there's a lot of species specificity, and so it would behoove us to figure out the tissues that are evolutionarily conserved, and phylotox is a great place to be doing that.
We can also dig deeper, actually, like maybe it's of interest to some people here, that we have done two single cell RNA-seq studies on brains of one strain, one in which we compared gene expression in response to cocaine that was published in Genome Research by Baker et al., and the other one in which we looked at developmental alcohol exposure, which has been published by Mukashi et al. In Frontiers in Psychiatry. And these studies really are, to me, were an eye-opener, or maybe a brain-opener, in that the diversity of transcriptional profiles across the brain is really quite extensive. And one of the beauties, of course, of Drosophila is that in Drosophila, the brains are small. They're not the smartest animals in the world. They have teeny brains. And we can therefore survey the entire brain in one analysis. You cannot really do that in rodents, where you either take a piece of hippocampus or a piece of frontal cortex. In Drosophila, we can look at the whole thing. And so this is, I think, a very, very nice avenue for the future in terms of toxicogenomics, looking at single cell responses.
How many cells did you actually get in those brains?
90,000. We're quite proud.
In
of
one
that.
Of them, there was 100,000. One of them was like near 90. It was about 80-something thousand.
88.
Others 100,000. I think we separated them in one paper in 36 clusters, and the other one in 43 cell clusters. And we identified pretty much each particular neurotransmitter type in the brain. We and most. Most brain regions. And we also looked could identify both glia and neuronal populations and annotate them based on markers, of gene expression markers.
Thank you, Nicolas. And sorry for interrupting Robert and Trudy and Daniel. Yeah. There is another question that go on from Peter Chervas, Peter, as well as for Nicolas, if you want to
yeah, I see that. Maybe Peter wants to read
yep.
it.
Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, it's a much, much more minor question than the ones that have been discussed, but I was struck by the absence of metallothionin from the list of important polymorphisms for for this response. Am I right to be a little surprised?
Maybe, or maybe not. So when we first started this GWAS business a long time ago, and QTL mapping business, we looked at bristle number, which is really well known, the developmental pathway. We looked at lifespan, which has a really well known mutations that affect lifespan. Did we find any of those in our studies? Not on your life. And so if you've done it before, you wouldn't be surprised. But if you hadn't done it before, you would be. The question is why? I'm going to hazard a guess that it's because when we do our GWASs in the DGRP proper, we are constrained to common variants. And so I am suspecting that for really, really important genes, that there's not very many common variants segregating in the population because they'd be selected against by natural selection. So it's a matter of, you use mutations to find out the gene set that's important, and that's one set of observations, but they may not be genetically variable in nature. But your last question I was really interested in. So what would happen if you put in a mutation, and how would that affect things? I think that is the direction in which we're going in many aspects of our work, especially that related to human genetic disease. Is this is a way of addressing the epistasis question. Put it in a known mutation in all these different backgrounds, mm-hmm. Do your GWAS, and now you can find the modifiers.
Yeah, the number of exciting experiments expands exponentially. Yeah. Good, thank you for the answer.
I'll add into that, we have two different methods for finding epistasis out of GWAS approaches. Given the raw data, we have one, a machine learning approach, and two, a network-driven approach to mine epistatic interactions that single SNP analysis will miss, and we sort of crack the combinatorial problem. As you look at what is eighth order epistasis in a human genome is on the order of 10 to the 40 possible combinations. 20th order epistasis is 10 to the 170. You can't brute force this, but we've found ways around that so that we can actually do epistasis at scale. That would be beautiful in Drosophila then, because you have the experimental tools to go in and validate those findings right away.
Exactly, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter, for your question. And thank you, Trudy, for the time to respond it. We have a last question, I see. So if you have any question, just feel free to write it in the chat. We have a few minutes. We have a last question from John Colburn. If also you want to ask it directly, John.
You can tell that I'm very excited by your presentation, Trudy and Robert. There's one example that I use in my Masters of Toxicology class, and that is of the arsenite methyltransferase gene. It's a very interesting one because a single amino acid change really radically changes the susceptibility to toxicity in humans. And the same gene can actually explain also differences that we see among species based on the same differences in now fixed amino acids among the species. I would be very curious to find out whether the same genetic reason for susceptibility for arsenite could actually be also this explained in the invertebrates like Drosophila.
Well, maybe we'll find out in the future. As I have mentioned to you, we are still in early stages with our analysis of arsenite. But it would not surprise me if an ortholog pops up.
I have to look at the gene and see whether it's got an ortholog in flies. I don't know.
It could, but I don't know. We would have to look whether there is an ortholog there.
The interesting thing about this gene is that it does so by epigenetic changes. Mm-hmm. And so it would require more functional conservation than just the function of the gene. You'd also have to conserve the whole methylation process between.
And there's no methylation in flies.
That's right. This may not be a DNA methylation. I'm not sure.
Okay. Yeah, it could. Yeah.
Good.
Okay, so we're slowly arriving at the end. I do not see any more question in the chat. So I think we can close this session of Q&A. I would like to thank you, Trudy. Thank you, Robert. Thank you, Maria and Eugene, for your incredible work. Thank you for this really interesting lecture. I would like to thank everyone that participated today. We will end this Café Scientifique, but we will have a next Café Scientifique. I will ask you to stay in touch on our website. Please visit our website, PrecisionTox. I will put it directly in the chat.
Can we have the exit music?
I can put some music for the end. Trudy or Robert, if you want to have a last word, maybe, just feel free to also.
Happy Birds Night, everybody. Enjoy
Happy
your,
Birds Night.
Enjoy your haggis, neeps, and toffees.
And thank you all very much for attending. And so, as we say, au revoir, arrivederci, hasta la vista, where everybody is. I'm sorry, I don't know the Finnish. Favesa was there on the call, but it was a pleasure. And I would like to thank you, Valentin, and Jean, for organizing.
Thank you very much.
Café Scientifique.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody. And we're going to keep you in touch for the next session of the Café Scientifique. Next time, it's going to be on C. elegans. More information coming soon. Thank you very much. The recording will be shared with you soon, as well as the people who could not join us today. Thank you again. And thank you again, Trudy and Robert and Valentin.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
So I have to go. I'll go in my office and join.